Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. I welcome you to another episode of our series, As-Safara to al-Kiram, where we strive to be in the company of the noble angels by perfecting our recitation of the Qur'an. As usual, we like to begin our episode discussing an important fact about the Qur'an. Now, everybody knows the word tafsir, which is the explanation, or in English, the exegesis is the precise word of the Qur'an. Tafsir is not just anything that you do based upon your whims and desires. Rather, there is a specific methodology that must be followed. The science of tafsir is one of the most important sciences of Islam. It is not allowed to merely pick up the Qur'an and read a translation and try to derive rulings from it. Rather, the only person who can do such an advanced work is a person who has studied the sciences of Islam, he has studied the science of tafsir, and he has studied the rules and the methodology by which you extract rulings, by which you extract hukum, we call it in Arabic, from the verses of the Qur'an. Now briefly, how is the science of tafsir done, and what is it based upon? Well, the first thing that a person who wishes to interpret the Qur'an looks at is the Qur'an itself. In other words, you must combine all the relevant verses about this particular topic. You cannot just take one verse out of context and ignore all the other verses regarding this particular thing. So the first thing that the scholar of tafsir looks at is the entire Qur'an itself. What might be summarized in one place will be expounded upon in another. What might be hinted at in one verse will be mentioned explicitly in another verse. After this, the scholar then goes on to the second source, and that is of the sunnah. So the Qur'an is interpreted by the statements of the Prophet ﷺ. A person who ignores this source can never understand the Qur'an properly. Who better to interpret the Qur'an than the one upon whom it was revealed? In fact, the Prophet ﷺ's interpretation can have no question about its authenticity. It must be correct because he is the Prophet of Allah. He is the one assigned by Allah to expound, to explain the verses of the Qur'an. So the Qur'an tells us how to pray, but it never tells us precisely how to pray. We look at the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, and we then understand the meaning of prayer by looking at the sunnah. The third point that we go to after the Qur'an and the sunnah, the third source is that of the statements of the companions. Because the companions were the most knowledgeable people after the Prophet ﷺ. So we turn to their interpretations and we see how they interpreted particular verses. If we find that the companions have agreed upon a particular interpretation, we are not allowed to leave that for any other. And if we find that the companions have differed, then we can pick and choose amongst their opinions that which seems to be the strongest. After this, we then move on to the Arabic language and poetry. This is because there are certain words in the Qur'an which out of the development of the language, they have fallen into misuse. People don't use them anymore. So they are very advanced and difficult words. Therefore, to understand them properly, we need to go back to Arabic language, to pre-Islamic poetry, to try to understand the precise meaning of certain phrases and verses in the Qur'an. Another source of tafsir is pre-Islamic custom. There are many verses in the Qur'an which refer to the practices of the people before Islam. For example, there's a reference in Surah Baqarah to enter your houses from the door and don't enter them from the backs. This is referring to a pagan custom that the Arabs would not enter their houses through the door at certain times of the year. Without knowing this custom, we will not be able to understand this verse. And another source of tafsir is ijtihad or personal reasoning based upon the various sciences that we have outlined. There are many, many books of tafsir. In fact, there are literally hundreds and hundreds of books of tafsir. The most famous one and the most encyclopedic one is that of Muhammad ibn Jarir al-Tabari, who died in the year 310 Hijri. It is an encyclopedic tafsir printed in over 30 volumes. But one which is more handy and alhamdulillah has been translated into English is that of tafsir ibn Kathir. Ibn Kathir died in the year 774 Hijra, and his tafsir is, in my opinion, the first reference that any serious student of knowledge should turn to in order to understand the Qur'an. With this introduction, let us now move on to our tajwīd topic. Last lesson, we were discussing various types of special idghams, a very advanced topic here. Special types of idghams, special types of mergings that occur in the Qur'an. Today, we will continue along those lines and finish up a discussion of the special types of idgham. Previously, we had discussed two types of idgham. What were they? Number one? What type was the first one? The same letter. We have the first letter silent, and then the same letter after it is not silent, so we merge the two together. And the second type was two letters of a close makhraj. If the first of them is silent and the second of them is not silent, then we're supposed to merge the two together. And we mentioned the examples of that. Today, we will now move on to the third type, and that is letters of similar characteristics. In other words, they are not close in their makhraj, but rather they are of similar characteristics. And in order to make things easy, I have given you an exhaustive list of the precise letters that are similar, so you know where to do them. Now notice the examples I will mention are not exhaustive, but these are. So every time you have a silent dhal followed by a dha, you will merge it together every time this occurs. So you can just write down, there are seven precise areas where this occurs, seven pairs of letters where we'll apply this. So we will go over all seven of these, so you don't have to memorize the rule, just memorize the particular examples. So we have over here, for example, إِذْ ظَلَمْتُمْ and إِذْ ظَلَمُوا. What do? We merge the dha with the alif and we drop the dhal sound. Whatever is heavier, because even if you try to pronounce the dhal and then the dha, إِذْ ظَلَمْتُمْ, you cannot do it properly. So in order to make it easy, the arrows would merely merge the dha with the dhal. إِذْ ظَلَمْتُمْ immediately. Likewise, إِذْ ظَلَمُوا. You just ignore the dhal, you just merge it together. And by the way, every time this occurs in the Qur'an, there will be a shadda over the dha or whatever the letter that is being merged in order to indicate to you that that should be merged. So every time you have a dhal and a dha, you will merge it together. Likewise, every time you have a ta and a dal, you will also merge together. Ujibat da'watukuma. Ujibat da'watukuma. Because we've merged it, there is no qalqala. Okay? And the dal has a fatha on it anyway, so there could not be a qalqala. But we have merged it, we dropped the ta. Ujibat da'watukuma. Immediately we move on to the dal. Okay? Because the dal is stronger than the ta. Realize, again, all of this is for ease. You cannot, even if you try to, you could not do justice to this if you try to pronounce it. Ujibatta. It wouldn't happen. Because the letters are too similar in characteristic. And if you remember, if you go back to what we did in characteristics, we also mentioned some of these letters and how close they come from and how similar they are in their characteristics. Likewise, the ta with the ta. فَآمَنَ الطَّائِفَ. We ignore the ta. فَآمَنَ الطَّائِفَ. The ta is completely dropped. And we merge the noon with the ta because it is not possible or it is very difficult to pronounce both of these letters individually. Similarly, the dal with the ta. Notice all of these are variations of the same. The ta with the dal, the dal with the ta with the ta, because they're so similar to one another. Anytime any of these letters occurs, one of them being silent and the other one following it, then you will merge the heavier of the two. You will merge the heavier of the two or the easier of the two. In this case, qad تبين أردتم كت مهدت. Okay, so you will merge them together and drop the middle letter. All of this is to make the pronunciation easier. Likewise, you have the ba and the meem, and this only occurs once in the Quran, where you have a silent ba followed by a meem. What do? You drop the ba and you say إركم معنا. Because there will be an idgham, they will put a shadda. What will the shadda do with the meem? The shadda will put a ghunna on it. So you'll have irkam ma'ana, irkam ma'ana. So there'll be a shadda on the meem. Likewise, the tha and the dha. Okay, again, there's only one place that's occurred. The dhal, excuse me, the tha and the dhal. Yalhath dhalika. You will drop the tha and you will say yalhath dhalika. Yalhath. You will drop the tha and move on directly. And the final case where this occurs is the ta with the ta. Again, our whole da, the ta and the dal and the ta, basically any combination of these that occurs, like basalt, ahattu, farrattum, right? Basalta, ahattum. All of this, you will merge it because it is not possible to pronounce the two and give justice to each letter. So in this case, you will give preference to the ta because it is the heavier of the two. Okay, even though this is the one coming first, but you'll give preference to this. Okay, la'im basalta, basalta. Likewise over here, ahalta. Over here, farrattum, farrattum. You will give preference to the heavier of the two because it is a the stronger of the two in characteristics. So look at this list again. We have seven particular pairs. We have the dhal and the dha. We have the ta and the dal. We have the ta and the ta. The dal and the ta. The ba and the meem. Tha and thal. And ta and ta. Anytime these seven letters occur, the first one of them being silent, the second one is not silent, then you must perform idgham between them, which means that in almost all cases you will take the second letter, but in this case, because it is the heavier of the two, you will take the first, which is the ta, and the other letter will be dropped completely. Now, just as a side point, some ulama, or there are some scholars that can actually do this, that they pronounce both of them in its proper place, so they say that it is allowed to do so, but this should only be done by someone who has studied the science very well and has studied it under a qari or a hafiz or a sheikh, so that he knows how to pronounce it. This is more difficult to pronounce both of them. So the easier of the rule is what I'm teaching you, is that you just perform idgham. You might, if you hear a cassette or if you hear a famous qari, you might hear him not do idgham because he is qualified and he has studied it under the sheikh or the teacher. However, as for our level, the beginning level, it is far easier just to follow the rule of idgham and to just merge the letter together. So as practice, let me recite the last verse of Surah Al-Hashr. Surah Al-Hashr is the, or excuse me, Surah Al-Saff, that is true, Surah Al-Saff, yes. Surah Al-Saff is the 61st surah in the Qur'an. The 61st surah in the Qur'an. And we'll quiz you on the rules again, all of the rules that we have done so far.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم يا أيها الذين آمنوا كونوا أنصار الله كما قال عيسى بن مريم كما قال عيسى بن مريم للحواريين من أنصاري إلى الله قال الحواريون نحن أنصار الله فآمن طائفة من بني إسرائيل وكفر الطائفة فأيدنا الذين آمنوا على عدوهم فأصبحوا ظاهرين.
Okay, we have too many rules here to really go over, but let us go over some of them. Ya ayyuha. What is the ruling on ya ayyuha? Who can tell me?
Connected.
Connected or separated? It is separated mad. Even though when you look at it, it might look like a connected mad, but it is in fact two words. Ya ayyuha. So I have a choice of 2, 4, 5, therefore I want to emphasize that. Lil hawariyina man ansari. Man ansari ilallah. This is a
separated
mad. قال الحواريون نحن أنصار الله فآمنت. Aha, what happened here? Exactly. Look at this. We have a ta followed by a ta. فآمنت طائفة. So we did idgham. We dropped the ta. You don't hear the ta sound. فآمنت طائفة من بني. What happened with the mim? What is this? إقلاع. We have a silent noon followed by a ba. إسرائيل. What type of mad?
Connected.
It's a connected mad. So you have to go it 4 or 5. وَكَفَرَ الطَّائِفَ. Once again we have the idgham. فَأَيَّدْنَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا عَلَى عَدُوِّهِمْ فَأَصْبَحُوا ظَاهِرِينَ. What type of mad is on the ظَاهِرِينَ at the end? عَادِ السُّجُونَ. Because we stopped over there. Okay. This brings us to the conclusion of another episode. We hope to see you next time. Until then, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.